Welcome to module 5. The title of this module 5 is Geotechnical Investigations for Dam and Reservoir. I am Professor Mohammed Masroor Alam from Department of Civil Engineering, AMU, Aligarh. In this module, you will be able to learn about different kinds of dams, reservoirs, and their important parts. You will be able to know about the spillways, which are used for drying out water from the reservoir. You will be able to learn different important geomorphological and geological investigations carried out for construction of dam and reservoir. After completion of this module, you will have an idea that in what ways dam can fail and what remedial measures we can take place to strengthen the rock mass and foundation. You will come to know about different kinds of dams which we have in India and their importance. Dams are defined as artificial structures made across a river in a river valley using different kinds of material. We can use wood logs, wood planks, steel planks, rocks, earth, and masonry for making dams. Dams are made to impound water, which can in turn be used to moderate flood, to generate hydroelectricity, or even to supply water through the canals for irrigation. When we make dams, there are many other structures which are associated with the dam. For example, a reservoir, spillways, service roads, canal headworks, etc. The dams can be classified based on their height, based on their purpose, and based on the material used. We can call a dam a small dam if it has got a height less than 15 meters. If it is from 15 to 50 meters, then we call it large dams. And if it is from 50 to 150 meter height, then we call it major dam. And if it is more than 150 meter height, then we call it big dam. As far as purpose of constructing dam is concerned, we can have dams which can be called as check dams if it is made to check the sediment movement. We can call barrage or weir if we are making dams just for diverting water into the canals. We can also have multi-purpose dams in which we are using it for many different purposes, starting from raising the water level to flood moderation to generation of hydroelectricity. As far as materials are concerned, we can have earth dam if we are using borrowed earth to make that dam. We can call it rock fill dam if we are using rock rubble to construct a dam. And if we are using masonry or concrete, then we call it concrete or masonry dam. There are some dams which are called as zone dams because they are made up of different materials in different places within the dam. For example, in mixed zone dam, what we have clay core. Over the clay core, we used to have rocks, and above the rocks, we can have concreting just to stop the seepage from reservoir towards the downstream of the river. The concrete and masonry dams are further classified into gravity dam, buttress dam, and arch dams. Now, what kind of dams we are going to have along across a river, that will depend what kind of foundation rocks are there. If we have very weak rocks, then we'll go for earth dam. The regions where we have earthquakes or we have permafrost condition, we will go for rock fill dam. And in the regions where we have very strong rocks in the foundation, then we will go for gravity dam. Buttress dams are made when we have alternate strong and weak rocks. Then the main structure, main dam, is made on the strong rocks, and then it is supported by cross walls, which are called buttresses. Arch dams normally are made when we have very high thrust of water from the reservoir, and the curve is made upstream so that the water thrust is deflected towards the abutment. So in arch dams, we have to have not only strong foundation rocks, but also strong abutment rocks. For detailed geological and technical investigations, which involves engineering geologists as well as civil engineers, we have to see before even planning of dam and reservoir that what are the conditions present on the ground. For this, we can start with office study, then we can go for some remote sensing or satellite imageries to see the overall region covering the catchment area of the river which is to be dammed, as well as the reservoir area and the locations for the dam. For detailed geological investigation and field studies, we have to go into the field, and there we have to conduct surveys on a small scale so that we can find out the minute details of rocks, and we can predict the behavior of rock mass once it is subjected to loading by dam as well as by reservoir. Now, the most important thing is the force exerted by dam and reservoir. There are different kinds of forces which will be exerted on the founding rocks by the dam, which may be vertical forces and which may be lateral forces. The vertical forces are because of weight of the dam, because of weight of the water column, because of weight of the sediment which are stored in the dead storage area. Then if we have some service road, then whatever live load we have, that can also be added into the vertical downward load. This vertical downward load is somewhat cancelled by what is called as pore water pressure and buoyancy, which is due to the submergence of the dam. The resultant vertical force will provide the stability to the dam. There are lateral forces which are exerted by the thrust given by the reservoir water, the thrust given by the wave action at the top of the reservoir, and the forces of the wind over the freeboard. All these lateral forces, they act in the downstream direction. The resultant force of these two is very important. This resultant force should lie within the foundation of dam. If it is close to the vertical forces, then stability of the dam will be ensured. And if it goes beyond the foundation of dam towards the lateral force, instability of the dam will take place. Most of the dams have failed when this lateral force have become very large, either due to the smaller or lesser number of spillways, and the water has not been able to go out of the reservoir through the required space. This results into overtopping of the reservoir, which increases the buoyancy force as well as lateral force. This results into the toppling of the dam and dam fails. So it is very important to estimate that what is the highest amount of water we can have in our reservoir. For this, we have to see the history of that river and the history of the maximum flood. Because if maximum flood has not been taken into account, we cannot decide this exposed part of the dam, the height of the exposed part of the dam, which is called as freeboard. Freeboard is provided so that water level can rise for a while if spillways are not able to throw out all the waters in the reservoir. The geological investigations mainly concentrate on the rock types below the foundation of the dam and also the rock types into the reservoir area. The rock types below the foundation of the dam is very important because it is going to withstand the load which is exerted by the dam. Now this load can be very well accommodated if the rocks are very strong. So if you have a single rock type, then that is the best situation. And if this single rock type is either igneous rock or non-foliated metamorphic rocks, then this rock will behave in much better way and will be able to withstand all the load exerted by the dams. But if we have non-foliated rocks or sedimentary rocks, they are layered rocks, they are weak rocks, and they may not be able to withstand the overall load. So it all depends that what is the size of the dam, what is the size of the reservoir, and accordingly we have to go for designing the dam foundation. Now a big issue with the dam foundation is that water which is present in the reservoir, that should not seep into the foundation. And to protect the foundation from seepage, we normally construct a wall just at the heel of the dam so that the path of water goes below this wall and it should not go below the foundation of the dam. Because if the water reaches below the foundation of the dam, the pore water pressure or fracture water pressure increases, which acts against the vertical force which provides the stability. So seepage is not warranted into the foundation. The earth dams, they are more amenable to failure because they are made by using borrowed earth. They are brought to the site of the dam and they are compacted. They are compacted by rollers at optimum moisture content. Each soil or each different kinds of earth has got optimum moisture content over which it can be compacted very well. So the earth dams, if not contacted well, then they are likely to fail. There are many different methods of their flow. If you see the figure, the flow can be through piping. The seepage creates hole through the earth dam and water can gush out through that piping. The dam can fail if water is seeping through the main body of the dam, forming a waterfront. The seepage can also take place below the berm of the dam and it may go into downstream area below the foundation of the dam. Or it can also go out of the reservoir through seepage below the cutoff wall. So in this way, the seepage can fail the dam. If seepage starts taking place, then one cannot maintain the reservoir water level and dam itself comes in danger of failure. The dams, especially the earth dams, can also fail if we suddenly lower down the reservoir water level. The sudden lowering of reservoir water level releases the pore water pressure, which results into the failure of the dam, just like the earth sliding. The dam can fail on the downstream side also, along the waterfront, which becomes a place of discontinuity between dry earth and moist earth. So the dam, the dry part of the earth, can fail in the downstream. Sometimes earth dams have failed under the vibration created by the earthquakes. Now spillways are another very important part of the dam. The spillways are responsible for taking water out of the reservoir and throwing it into either the downstream or into the canal. Now spillways can be of different types. It can be made through the dam, it can be made as a base over the dam, it can be made through side of the dam, and this spillway is always a concrete structure, even if your dam is earth dam. So even in earth dam, there is always a concrete part of that dam, that is the spillway. So design of a spillway is very important, and that needs thorough knowledge of the water coming into the reservoir in the seasons when we have maximum of rainfall. So ultimately, the most important thing is the geological investigation. In geological investigation, as you know, that the rock which is present, that is very important. Apart from that, again, the structures which are present in that rock is going to control the behavior of that rock mass. And here we'll have joints going to play the most important role, because the overall behavior will depend of rock mass, that how many number of fracture sets are present, how they are oriented, what are their density, what are their numbers, what are the aperture conditions, what is their lateral and vertical persistence. So ultimately, it is the joints which are going to control the behavior of rock mass, and then the presence of shear zones. If the shear zones are present in the reservoir area, then water from the reservoir area will seep through the shear zone and will go out of the reservoir. It may also reach into the formation. So shear zones have to be taken very seriously, and they have to be sealed off so that no water seepage takes place from the shear zone. Lot of socio-economic factors and lot of environmental factors crop up when we go for construction of a big dam. The reservoir area, if it is already inhabited by populace, then those people have to be shifted from their place of living, which results into a lot of resentment from the local populace. So this results into a lot of delay in not only starting the project, but also litigations take place, and even the completion of project becomes highly delayed. There are a lot of environmental issues, because when we make reservoir, we are changing the riverine system into the lacustrine system. This results into excessive impoundment of water, which may result into reservoir-induced seismicity, which may increase the groundwater level above the before the dam in the upstream side, and lowering of groundwater table with time in downstream side. Lot of submergence take place, which may result into the submergence of grassland, submergence of forest, drowning of species which have not yet been identified and counted. So there is an issue of loss of biodiversity. So there are a lot of environmental issues which have to be taken into consideration before construction of dam is started. And we should try to replace the biota, flora and fauna at some other places so that the biodiversity is not lost. So we have to go for environmental impact assessment before starting any project as far as construction of dam is concerned. Now, as far as our own country, India, is concerned, we have more than 4,000 dams. Out of this, 3,500 dams are those dams which are having height less than 30 meters. There are dams which are having height 30 to 50 meters, numbering almost 500. We have 100 dams which are having height from 50 to 100 meters, and we have 30 dams having height from 100 to 150 meters, and 10 dams having height from 150 to 200 meters, and we have 2 dams which are having height more than 200 meters. These 2 dams are Bhakra Namangal Dam, which is present in Himachal Pradesh, which was made on Shivalik sandstones. It is a concrete dam. Then we have Tehri Dam, which is 261 meter high, which is the highest dam in India. This dam was constructed on weak rock mass, that is phyllite, and that's why we have gone for earth dam. So if you have weak rocks, you will go for earthen dam. So Tehri Dam was made on weak rocks, that is phyllites, and the dam is having height more than 261 meters and length almost 650 meters. The base width is almost 950 meters. So the base width of this dam is more than the length of the dam, something which is very peculiar. But just to provide extra strengthening to this dam, because it is lying in seismic zone 4 and 5, so that's why they have gone for a very broad dam. Apart from this, we have very famous Hirakud Dam in Orissa. We have Sardar Sarovar Dam in Gujarat. All these dams are very important and famous dams which have come in India in last 50, 60 years or so. Though we had a very long history of making dam, we had a dam in Madhya Pradesh known as Virnam Dam, constructed in 11th century, and then Mukut Dam in Bhopal, constructed in 15th century. So India is developing as far as infrastructure is concerned, and lot of dams are coming, mostly in Himalayan regions, which needs to be investigated thoroughly for the successful life of the dam and reservoir and the purpose for which it is going to be constructed.